in order that she may introduce Suzanne Bellamy and whoever else she may be. So without further ado, there are a few timetable changes, but they needn't concern you now because you have your minds on better things. Everybody relevant has been told, so they will emerge later. For a moment, I want to introduce Diane Gillespie, who will then introduce Suzanne and her many personas.
Objects, a five-panel painted interpretation of Woolf's For the Miami University Ohio Conference in 2007, she created a libretto for five voices based on a sketch of the past. For this one, Suzanne stitched together like a quilt, voices against a painted fragment of background that suggested impending air raids. I'm delighted to introduce Suzanne Bellamy and another of her inventive and performance pieces and wonderful painted backdrops, based this time on Woolf's later writings, including Between the Acts. This special plenary event is entitled The Play's the Thing, But We Are the Thing Itself, Prologue, Performance, Epilogue.
Vision, as it's all in there, you know, and at a certain point painting shouldn't explain that, you know, I could draw on that, but I'm not going to. And then I thought about the pageant itself, and having done an earlier pageant, now these illustrations, these slides that you're seeing, which are just to give you a general idea, took place on Twelfth Night, January the, is it the 6th, I think it's Twelfth Night, the 12 days after Christmas, in my home village, Mongalo, New South Wales, on my own land, and with the people from my village. And I wrote the script, well, I wrote something like a script, and they had no idea what they were doing either. And so you can get a sense of what happened. We made all the costumes, and what happened was that my friend Margaret, who we always threw parties together, said, we have to have a party, and I said, oh, let's do some theatricals. And then that night she said, I've rung everybody and I've told them there's going to be a pageant. So we were committed, so I then wrote the pageant. 10 days later it happened. And the trope of this pageant is that I played Chaucer, and my friend Angela from the supermarket played Shakespeare. She could quote, she was brilliant, she was also an editor. But it's so like Woolf's pageant in that just ordinary people from the village just said yes, they would be in it. So this just gives you an idea of what happened. And the trope in this one was that there was a dialogue between Chaucer and Shakespeare about how in that 200 years between the two of them, somehow actors got into the picture and everything got out of control. And there's an actor strike and all this sort of thing. So it's a very complex, long process that goes on in that pageant. But the bit I want to say is that I had briefed them. My most favourite moment was when I stood in front of them with the boat behind. It's about people who are, it's a post-colonial script in which six couples are shipwrecked and they lose their memories, they lose their minds, and they have to reconstruct their life in a new environment with the help of this funny village Indian people. And my favourite moment was when I stood in front of them and I said, have we all read the script? And they said, nope. They didn't care. They were so excited being in costume. And I thought that was my first real insight into this Latrobe's pattern. That you know what? We know what to do. We know how to do it. So for the purposes of today, I mean the third phase of my experiment, apart from the painting and the script for the pageant, is a whole exegesis with this, which is terribly academic, so I'll just assure you that it is. It's terribly academic. And I've read all the books, and Gail's group, Lulu, and various other people were marvellous, and of course the brilliant Mark Hussey's edition of Between the Apes came out at the perfect moment, and so that will end up in my paper, and I'm not going to talk about that now, it may come out in the discussion. I think what we should do is go on with the show, because I want you to know, though, that there's a kind of a script, and it's more a reading. The point I decided about the pageant, from Woolf's point of view, is that you can't repeat what she does. I read her pageant, and I thought, it's about the moment. You don't do something that was written for in the moment again. So I had to write a new one. So what you'll see has happened is that our pageant has all her characters in it, not her pageant. And then there are unfolding stories, as she has the unfolding stories, I've written some new ones. So without further ado, we will move to the play. And please participate as you feel moved. plot about the plot. The plot's nothing. Now it's early morning. Mrs. Swithin drew the curtain in her bedroom, her favourite reading, An Outline of History. Thinking of rhododendron forests in Piccadilly, the iguanodon, the mammoth and the mastodon, from whom we descend.
On the terrace.
Every summer for 7 years now, I had heard the same words. Would it be wet or fine? And every year it was one or the other.
How do we begin this talk? The pharaohs, the dentist, fish? Oh yes, who ordered fish? Mrs. Van Rosen. If it comes to a pinch this afternoon, will you sing?
This afternoon, the pageant. Is it in the Hetherington? Or is it in the Butte Hall? Is it the pageant?
The very place. That's the place for a pageant. Winding in and out between the trees. There's the stage, there's the audience, and down there among the bushes, perfect place.
Where did Miss Latrobe spring from? She'd been an actress. Very little was known. She used rather strong language. She had a passion for getting things up. Nature had set her apart from her kind, the actress in her bed.
One day we wrote the play ourselves. People are gifted. The question is how to bring it out. That's why she's so clever, Miss Latrobe. Of course, there's a whole of English literature to choose from. But we remain seated. We are the audience.
We remain seated. We are the audience.
Words this afternoon ceased to lie flat on the sentence.
We haven't the words, we haven't the words behind the eyes, not on the lips. That is all.
Thoughts without words, can that be?
What fun! Well, for myself, I can't put two words together once I hold a pen.
It has the makings.
Another play always lay behind the play she had just written. Vanity made them all malleable. They squabbled, but she kept time it. Don't worry about the plot. The plot's nothing.
We have other lives, I think, I hope. We live in others. We live in things.
I'm William.
See my seaweeds. Come and see my seashells. Come and see my dicky bird hop upon his perch.
What a tosh. The first play, Janet, and then with Peter, and then with Claire. Vanessa is in love with Roger. This is Clive, is in love with Mary. Lynn is in love with Ralph, is in love with Carrington. Who's in love with Lytton? Duncan is in love with Bunny. Who marries Angelica, but no one tells Angelica who her dad is. And now Vanessa is in love with everyone. Peter loves Hilda and various other women, but Virginia outs her in a novel. But it's all in the end, no problem, the end. This card takes place behind the bushes.
I should hope so.
Does the plot matter? It was only there to beget emotion, only two emotions, love and hate. There was no need to puzzle out the plot. The plot's nothing, verbiage, repetition. Peace was the third emotion, love, hate, peace. Three emotions made up the play of life. Didn't matter what the words were or who sang what. Round and round they whirled, intoxicated by the music.
Thank you.
were all caught and caged, prisoners watching a spectacle. Nothing happened.
And after that, what?
Prison time, ourselves, and William.
The second play within a play. Title. They want lots, do they? In which €3 are exchanged, and a panel of writers and public intellectuals debate spectacle and propaganda in a CNN BBC hardtop co-production. They dissect Dominic Strauss time, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Vlad Topolanic, Silvio Berlusconi, and the Saudi royal family, with references to the IMF, the World Bank, Fukushima radiation spread, the killing of Osama bin Laden, the global financial crisis, the bankruptcy of Europe, climate change, and the royal wedding. They twitter throughout. The end. All this takes place behind the bushes.
What's the object of this entertainment?
A fund for installing electric light in the church.
For installing electric light in the church. But its festivals end with a demand for money. Nothing's done for nothing in England.
Nothing. All their nerves were on edge. They sat exposed. They were neither one thing nor the other. They were suspended. How long was she going to keep them waiting? Present. Ourselves.
What could she know about ourselves? It was ridiculous. What's she keeping us waiting for?
Try 10 minutes of present time. Swallows and cows. Reality is too strong, cousin. Oh, to write a play without an audience. Panic seized her. This is death. And then the shower fell, like all the people of the world weeping. Then it stopped. Nature had once more taken her part.
A cow is a cow.
I think it's clever.
history.
My dear, I thought it utter. I thought it utter. I thought it utter and utter. Why you like the opera?
Apparently this notion, so I'm told, is nothing solid.
Great souls, so very sensible.
What a difference. Nobody seems to know one car from the other.
Dear me, the parking arrangements are not what they are.
In Glasgow
University. The filmers had bruised the lane on the grass. The longer we eat a great deal of it, the better it is.
Sorry for being late.
What was we to thank about?
Thank the actors, not the author. Only about the army.
It's a divorce, my dear.
At last, Miss Latrobe could say to the world, the gift meant nothing. Then something rose to the surface. What would the first words be? The words escaped her. Words of one syllable sank down in the mud. The mud became fertile. Words rose. Words without meaning. Wonderful words. She set down her glass. She heard the first words. Down in the hollow at Point's Hall, play still hung in the sky of the mind. Hadn't she, for 25 minutes, made them see?
Surely it was time someone invented a new plot, or that the author came down with the bushes.
England was a swamp. Thick forests covered the land. Birds sang, then the curtain rose.
It's an age when we are not fast angels, but we are. Things are moving around us. We are moving in ourselves.
Now, the epilogue began.
But it's all just conversation between her and her friends.
What utter tosh, my dear.
Just her and her cronies.
No man is free from speaking foolish things, but the worst of it is when a man labors to play the fool. But what do I know?
She has enjoyed the relaxing ease of an uncritical, not to say flattish.
What utter tosh, my dear.
She's suffered no worse injury from mankind than a rare, unfavorable review.
Chaucer's time, we should see trucks across the fields joining manor house to hobble while we do between the houses in the village has been grown over, like the trough along which the pilgrims rode to Canterbury. No one rides that way now. Before Chaucer's time, it was trod daily, to the old graves, to the stones, to the tree, to the well, enacting ancient paths.
There never was, it seems, a time when men and women were without a memory. There never was a young world. That is the world beneath our consciousness, the anonymous world to which we can still return. The voice is still the voice of anon.
In the old days, when English was a new language, writers would invent words and use them. How can we combine the old words in new order so that they survive from their beauty? Tell the truth. Words are the wildest, free, the most irresponsible, freest, most irresponsible, most unteachable of all things. We live in the mind. They believe that one mind is as good as another. They hate being useful. They hate making money. For it is their nature to change. When words are pinned down, they fold their wings and die. Our unconscious is their privacy. Our darkness is their light. Here we are, ourselves, Glasgow, 2011, in the present moment. The mind became fertile. Words do not live in dictionaries, they live in the mind. The truth they catch is many-sided, and they convey it by being themselves many-sided. Thus they mean one thing to one person, another thing to another person, unintelligible to one generation, plain as a pikestaff to the next. We are not fast anchored where we are. Things are moving around us. We are moving ourselves. Pilgrims are we.
Good.
I just want to know whether you're
changed after the, whether you changed the script over the last 2 days. No?
Well, has it been another disaster or a sex scandal?
No, it occurred to me from the fact that Montagne and Gertrude Simon across the stage have been papers about them.
Of course, but I had already planned to have them. And I had wanted to have also Jane Harrison, but Jean Mills, who couldn't come, had to be Jane Harrison. So in honor of Jean Mills, we don't have Jane Harrison. But I wanted there to be that collaging. So the biggest call I made in terms of the script was to have Queenie readers. Because, you know, it's a complex relationship she had with Woolf, the caterpillar put down and, you know, effectively alienated Woolf from the canon and from literature for several decades, and which is much to answer for. But I think Queenie readers is a complex character. But what I wanted was that for us to move more into panto than pageant. And Jane and I thought it was the most wonderful day from the panto that we could ever have had. She could take the booze. They don't need the conference organizer to take the booze. What a gal.
Okay, is it? I don't like to say
something. No, we might leave them with it.
Well, I just want to commend you for this creative venture that you're doing with so many different fronts. And I wondered if you were familiar with Poets Theater, because this is very reminiscent of that. In San Francisco, we have Poets Theater, which is basically a scripted performance that's rehearsed the day before once. And then people walk around with the scripts and they do poetry in the same way that you just did with Jane Woolf. So.
No, that's interesting. But in my very scholarly months, I had looked at Edith Sitwell's Facade, which Woolf had seen, and also Forster's England's Present Land, and the whole rural revivalist movement. I mean, her pageant sits in the context of a really rich period in the 30s of anxiety about the potential loss, the collection of folklore for millions of, you know, her pageant really is soaked in what she was already seeing during that period. And that wonderful book by Alexandra Harris, The Romantic Novels, it's really helpful to me. I found that it's a wonderful book. She, I think, is going to be at the conference next year. And, you know, she looks at how all the modernists who had been sort of categorized as very urban and cosmopolitan, many turned their attention to the crisis of the countryside and development and culture and where this culture comes from, as it was under threat. So, you know, I think that we have to see her pageant as a really complex political form. And of course, there's all those other arguments made about pageantry at that period, including the Nazi use of the pageant, etc. So there's huge layers and layers of work that one can do on between the Access Marx book so beautifully shows up. So, you know, it's hard to capture all that, but it's one experience of the present moment. What I want to know is how all my actors felt.
Well, they're probably hungry.
We will talk about
that. I was going to say, thank you, Suzanne. How do we follow that? Well, we follow it with lunch and a queer wolf panel. What else could follow this? First, we must thank Suzanne Bellamy.